Well, it was the Sabbath day that this healing took place, as I mentioned. Jesus, though he could have healed him with just his word, you know, restore your sight, boom, brought it back. He actually went through a process with this guy. We looked at this last week, but just to review, remember he basically spit in some dirt and made kind of a little mud there, and he put it on his eyes, told him to go wash. And again, I think that part of that was really the Lord going out of his way to violate the traditions of these guys concerning the Sabbath. For again, God said, yes, keep the Sabbath. It's a sin to break the Sabbath. But it was these religious leaders over the centuries that came up with various traditions and codified them in very specific, detailed ways as to what constitutes a violation of the Sabbath. And Jesus is doing actually multiple things here to violate their idea of the Sabbath. And of course, the healing is the big one. So, you know, they asked the blind guy, the Pharisees do, you know, now what did he do to you? And he says, well, he made some mud, then he put it on my eyes, you know, and all these kind of things. They're probably just cringing when they're hearing these details. And of course, it's all on the Sabbath. Now, the man who is healed, obviously, is saying, oh, this man's a prophet. In other words, he's a godly man. But they're convinced that he must be some sort of a sinner because, again, in their minds, no godly man would do such things on the Sabbath. And yet, they've got this conundrum because, again, we're talking about the healing of a blind man, a man born blind. It just didn't happen. They actually doubted he was blind. They said, this guy wasn't really blind. This is all set up. And they got his parents involved, if you'll recall. And his parents were afraid to really deal with them. And they didn't really stick up for their son like I believe a parent should. We mentioned it, the fact that it's possible that this guy here is actually, you know, maybe in his teenage years. He may not be a, you know, older adult man who's been around for a while, which makes the intimidation they try all the more terrible. And the fact that the parents didn't really, you know, take a stand for him, also unfortunate. But we're told that the parents did not want to be excommunicated, kicked out of the synagogue. And so they were fearful to really speak up. And so we've kind of summarized there to bring us to verse 24, which is where we left off. We looked at verse 23 and then we stopped. So verse 24, after the Pharisees deal with the parents, they again called the man who was blind. And they said to him, give God the glory. We know that this man is a sinner. Now, give God the glory. I mean, the idea is, you know, don't give the glory to this guy. You know, give it to God who healed you. But also just more of an expression of really, you know, tell us the truth. You know, what's really going on? Joshua did that in the book of Joshua when he was confronting that guy Achan who had sinned against the Lord. And he had been revealed that he was the guilty person in Israel. And Joshua's words to Achan was, my son, I beg you, give glory to the Lord God of Israel and make confession to him. Tell me now what you have done. Do not hide it from me. Give God the glory. You know, come clean. And so here we have them throwing this on the guy, and they say, we know that this man is a sinner. We know this guy's a sinner. And of course, for them to say that, again, goes back to their beliefs, their traditions over the Sabbath. Jesus certainly never sinned, but he has no occasion thus far for them to accuse him of sin. So for them to say, we know he's a sinner, based on what? The only thing they've got is all the Sabbath stuff that I've been talking about. But that's enough for them. And that's unfortunate because it's a good reminder how, you know, we might have some preconceived ideas of what a Christian is supposed to look like and what they're supposed to do and not do. And, you know, we have to be careful when those are outside the realm of Scripture, because they're just in the realm of maybe tradition or our little denominational thinking or whatever it might be. God knows the heart. But when they say that, we know this man is a sinner, it leads to this response from the blind man in verse 25. He answered and said, hey, whether he's a sinner or not, I don't know. One thing I know, that though I was blind, now I see. Just laying out the testimony. Hey, I don't care what you think about him. That's not my call. I know this. I was blind, and now I can see, and it's because of him. You can imagine Christians throughout the centuries telling people that. People want to argue theology, want to argue things about religion and God and various, you know, faiths around the world or whatever. And a guy said, hey, one thing I know is I was a total drunk and Jesus sobered me up and got me clean. You know, I just know this. I had a terrible temper, but boy, Jesus just changed my heart. And a testimony. And that's kind of where this guy's at. Of course, in this situation, there is no alternate example. I mean, in other words, a drunk can get sober and an angry man can have his temper removed necessarily, don't necessarily need Jesus. But in this case, hey, I was blind and now I see, right? So then verse 26, they said to him again, what did he do to you? How do you open your eyes? And, you know, you just get to that part of the argument where it's just bogging down. You know, the police, when they suspect someone might not be telling the truth, they'll often ask them to repeat their story a second time or a third time. You know, the guy's like, I just told that officer. That, yeah, well, tell me too, you know. And what they're trying to do is make sure the details, that the things don't change. Now, wait a minute. Now, you said you never went out, but earlier you said you did go out to get people. So which way, you know, and they try to trap them. And so there's probably that idea. Now, tell us again what he did to see maybe this guy is making something up. Maybe, you know, they're still not fully sold. And so he just says, hey, verse 27, I told you already and you did not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? My story's not going to change, in other words. And then I think he's kind of going on the offensive here with a little zinger of his own. Do you also want to become his disciples? I mean, you cannot help but see in the context of all of this that he's really trying to kind of tweak their nose a little bit now, right? Now, well, you know, you want to hear to get, do you want to be his disciples? But tweak their nose he did because they get angry. Then they reviled him and they said, you are his disciple, but we are Moses' disciples. And let me just say this. In the Greek language, which is, of course, the language of the New Testament, Greek had pronouns like I, we, you, he, she, it, they, and so forth. A lot of times in the Greek language, pronouns were not used because there was a way that they could just be understood within the verb, okay? And other languages do this as well. English does not. So they would have different verb forms, little endings to a verb that would tell you what the pronoun is supposed to be, and that was often the case. So when they did use pronouns, typically it was for emphasis, right? And so that's what we have here. The pronouns are included in verse 28, and no doubt they are meant for emphasis. You are his disciple, but we are Moses' disciple. And that emphasis on the you compared to we, and it shows actually in the text of God's word in the original language. You don't necessarily see it in English. But also one other thing in the text of the language. I know it says you are his disciple, and it's a reference to Jesus. What they literally said is you are that one's disciple. It's a very insulting sort of way to address him, right? You know, we're Moses' disciple. You're that one's disciple. Trying to really bring that out in the original. And then, again, the insults kind of continue. Verse 29, we know that God spoke to Moses. And once more, in Greek, the idea is he spoke to Moses and what he said remains. You know, the idea of the law, right? He didn't speak to Moses 1,500 years earlier. No. he spoke to Moses, and it remains the law. You know, today we know that that came from God himself. But then again, as for this one, I know they added fellow in there just to give you the idea, but again, it's more insulting. As for this one, you know, that one, this one, it's a reference to Jesus, but very condescending sort of way. We do not know where he is from. Now, what cracks me up about him saying that, we don't know where he's from, is just a couple chapters earlier, a few weeks ago when we were in John chapter 7, when they were arguing about Jesus then. If you remember, their big complaint was that they knew he was from the Galilee region. And they said, look, the Messiah's got to be born in Bethlehem. Little did they know, right? But they're arguing, like, there's no Messiah coming from Galilee and all this kind of stuff. And they made a big deal, so they know where he's from. And yet here they are saying, we don't even know where this guy's from. Just showed up. And I mean, they're just flailing, aren't they? It's pretty pathetic. But look again at his response here in verse 30. The man answered and said to them, why, this is a marvelous thing that you do not know where he's from, yet he's opened my eyes. You know, you don't know where he's from, but yet look what he did. Now we know that God does not hear sinners. But if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, he hears him. Now, don't run crazy with that, you know, because obviously when we call on Jesus for salvation, God's hearing sinners. But the idea is more along the lines, as we're told in Scripture, it's not, you know, God's ear is not heavy and his arms that he can't hear and his arms not too short that he can't reach out, but your sins have separated you from him. In other words, the idea of trying to pray to God and looking for an answer and just seemingly not hearing anything. Well, you know, if you're in unrepentant sin, you need to confess your sins. You need to restore that wonderful fellowship with God that's available through the blood of Jesus Christ. So, you know, God doesn't hear sinners. In other words, if he was some horrible sinner, do you think God would be using him to go around healing people left and right? Especially healing the blind? But if you're a worshiper of God, do his will. He hears him. Verse 32 continues on. This is the blind man talking. Since the world began, it has been unheard of that anyone opened the eyes of one who was born blind. We have a couple times where someone might be struck blind for a moment in a similar way, like to the Apostle Paul, even though that was, of course, after all this took place. But in the Old Testament as well, there's an example of that. And, you know, it's just kind of struck blind for a while and then restored. But again, born blind. Verse 33, if this man were not from God, he could do nothing. And that really is the bottom line, isn't it? You know, and it's again, and I don't need to elaborate on this point with all of you, but just think about the alternative to what we know is the truth about Jesus Christ now that we're about 2,000 years in history since he walked the earth. I mean, how many people have been influenced by Christianity, the Christian religion, meaning influenced by Jesus Christ. Again, if it was all based on a lie, and some of the crazy things that unbelievers will say to us today, they'll say stuff like, oh, the Bible wasn't written by those guys way back then. The Catholic Church wrote the Bible during the Middle Ages to get everyone to believe in their religion so they can make money out. It's like, not only is that just so academically wrong, again, with you start looking at biblical texts and so forth that go back way before the Middle Ages. But it's like there's just no way you could have the kind of influence that continues on even to this present day if it was just all based on a lie, if it was just all made up. It's foolish. And isn't it fascinating how you have even so many people, groups, whether we call them cults, whether they're even other religions that want like their claim to Jesus too. They deny the biblical Jesus. I'm not talking about just another Christian denomination, like comparing Presbyterians to Baptists, to Methodists, to Lutherans, something like that. No, no, no. But I'm talking about the cultic groups that deny the deity of Jesus Christ, but yet their whole faith system is somehow connected to Jesus in some way, at least by name, by word. And then even totally different religions. You know, the Muslims have things to say about Jesus. Good things, right? Oh, prophet. And everyone has to. Why? Because you can't ignore him. You know, because again, who he is true, as we proclaim and as the Bible professes. And the idea that if it was all a fraud, if he didn't rise from the dead, going all the way back to those early disciples, the first apostles, who preached that message, hey, he rose from the dead, he showed himself to us. We know he died, and now we know he's alive. And they changed the world with that message. And the world has continued to be changed all these years. It absolutely just strains just pure rationality and common sense to imagine it's all based on a fraud, all based on a lie. Again, verse 33, if this man were not from God, he could do nothing. And then that really got him upset. So verse 34, they answered and said to him, you were completely born in sins, and are you teaching us? And they cast him out. Now, do you remember, we talked about this last week. The disciples had a question that was the sort of thing that was discussed by people when this man who was born blind, you know, they pass him. They said, who sinned, Lord? Did this man sin, like, in the womb, or did his parents somehow sin? You know, who's being punished by him being born blind? Did the parents bring this on this poor kid, or did he do it himself? And Jesus said, you know, neither is true. And we talked all about that last week. But you can see where that belief system was found in these Pharisees, can't you? You were altogether born in sins. You see, you can see where they were thinking in terms of his blindness. You think you're going to teach us? And notice, they cast him out. Now, that's talking about what we've talked about before, what the parents were worried about, that formal excommunication. This guy is getting booted out of the religious community of Israel for what? The crime of what? Receiving the miracle of Jesus and daring to maybe take a stand to the Pharisees and argue a little back with them? It's madness, isn't it? He hasn't done anything wrong. He can't even be accused of violating the Sabbath. You remember the guy that was crippled that Jesus healed? And he picked up his bed and was walking, and they accused him of violating the Sabbath because he was carrying his bed. He says, look, I'm only doing it because the guy who healed me told me to. And we had that discussion earlier. Here, he hasn't done anything. He's just sitting there. Jesus made the mud, put it on his eyes. He told him to go wash. That's the extent of his involvement in this. And yet, again, by simply receiving what Jesus had done in his life, that was enough for the enemies of the Lord to hate him enough to actually persecute him in this way. Sound familiar? You know, Jesus isn't here on earth anymore walking around. Hasn't been for quite a while. But his followers are. And so the unbelieving world takes out their hate on God upon his followers. And that's what we see here. They cast him out. Like I said, this is a huge deal because life was so, you know, religious centered. There wasn't this idea of, you know, separation of state and temple or whatever you would call it back then. No, I mean, life for a Jew was all about worship in the temple, the weekly synagogue worship. To not be a part of that, to be kicked out of that. And where do you go? I think I mentioned this before. We live in a time, especially in America, where for whatever reason, if someone is in sin, of course this guy's not, but if someone is in sin and gets kicked out of a local church, well, he can probably find another church a couple miles down the road and keep on keeping on, right? this guy's not going to have anywhere to go. But here's the other thing about this. Let's put ourselves in his situation for a moment. He was born blind. I think it's safe to assume that he probably, and this is not a commentary on the great things that people who are born blind can do. Don't misunderstand me on this. Putting ourselves back in time here. He probably did not learn a trade skill, right? He probably didn't have much even of an education. They didn't have, you know, Braille books. There was a lot of, you just imagine that. And so what was he doing? He was a beggar. Like blind people, sadly, in those days were. That's why they typically hung out near the temple and in Jerusalem and so forth, because that's where people are going to worship, and they might have a generous heart, you know, and they want to help. And here are these poor people that are blind and, or crippled or whatever other handicaps they may have. And so he's not blind anymore. He doesn't really have that same cause for begging. I mean, or put it another way, why is anyone going to give him any money? Especially when there's others who are still in difficult circumstances that someone could help out. But at the same time, we'll go get a job, but what skills does he have? And what education does he have? You know, just imagine the setup here. And now he's an outcast. He's been kicked out of the religious community. Who's going to hire him anyway? What faithful Jew is going to want this guy on the payroll? He's an outcast. And again, not to try to read too much into it, but as I said last week, and I know most of you were here last week, you wonder even to the extent he could even go back home to mom and dad. They're so fearful of the Pharisees and what the Pharisees might do to them as far as kicking them out. What if he says, Mom, Dad, I need to stay? Well, son, you know, we're afraid they're going to get upset if we bring... Who knows where they're at? Again, I don't want to say more than the Bible says, but this guy is in a very difficult place right now, isn't he? And it's in that very difficult place. He's just been kicked out. These thoughts that I just shared are probably this, oh no, what do I do now? Where do I go? What am I going to do tomorrow? And, you know, I mean, his whole life has been sent in one way because of his blindness. Now what? And it's in that place that Jesus comes to him and meets him again. So verse 35, Jesus heard that they had cast him out. I love that. Now, again, it's a little different when he's there on earth. We don't know how he heard or who told or, you know, the rumors spread around. And you hear. But, you know, today we can say that. Jesus heard about whatever bad, difficult thing comes into our life. Whatever challenge we have, whatever difficulty there is. Hey, Jesus heard about it already. He already knows about it. And explained it to the disciples. And Jesus said that. So when the disciples came to him and said, why do you speak to them in parables? Talking about the multitudes. He says, because it's been given to you, my disciples, to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. But to them it has not been given. He goes, I speak to them in parables because seeing, they do not see. See what he's saying there? They're seeing him, or we're listening to him, we're watching him. Hearing, they do not hear, nor do they understand. You know, you can hear the words, the audible words through your ears, but that doesn't mean you actually understand what's being said. And then Jesus went on to say, and in them, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled, which says, hearing you will hear and shall not understand, and seeing you will see and not perceive. For the hearts of this people have grown dull. Their ears are hard of hearing, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears, lest they should understand with their hearts and turn so that I should heal them. It's on them. And that's what he's getting across here as we concluded that chapter. This idea of recognizing, I need Jesus. I am blind, if you will. Now, you know, if you did, you would have no sin. Of course, everyone has a sin. Everyone has a sin nature. But the idea of that stubbornness, that hard-heartedness, that spiritual blindness. See, we hear blindness, the word, and if we only think in terms of the physical, well, you feel sorry for people who are blind. But when we're talking about the spiritual blindness, recognize that this is not the same thing. I mean, no one typically wants to be blind. Blindness happens at birth. Blindness happens by accidents that take place and can cause the loss of sight. Blindness happens by disease. And sometimes not accident, can be, you know, deliberate as well, you know, assault or whatever. So the idea is, like, if someone's blind, you know, one of those things has happened to them and it's heartbreaking. But spiritual blindness, oh, I feel so sorry for them, you know, they just, oh, wait a minute. You know, their eyes, they have closed, God says. You see, that spiritual blindness is not something certainly beyond the power of God to remove, nor is it something that you can say the person has no responsibility for. Physical blindness, you don't have responsibility for. Oh, yeah, maybe if you don't take care of your diabetes or whatever and you lose your, you know, you could say, well, you're partly responsible, but we're not talking about that. We recognize that that's something that for the most part is a sad thing that, you know, is out of your control, or the consequences of something maybe you did that was foolish, like an accident or whatever. But spiritual blindness is different. And that's what Jesus is getting at here, that contrast. There really are just the two groups of people, aren't they? And so he says, you know, if you were blind, if you recognized, you know, like, oh, show me the truth. There was a time I was blind. I did not know the Lord, not physical blindness, of course. I did not know the Lord. I started reading the Bible to try to find out the meaning of life and purpose. Why are we here? You know, the big questions. Started reading the Bible, began to learn about Jesus in the Bible, began to learn about the claims. And I was born again eventually. It took a long time, many, many months, because I was reading as a spiritually blind person. But I knew I was spiritually blind. Whereas the person who says, oh, I don't need any of this religious stuff, I don't need anything about Jesus, they think they know it all. They, you know, I don't need any of that. They think they've got perfect sight. But they actually are the ones that are blind. And therefore, they're the ones that are in their sin. Your sin remains. My sins were washed away by the blood of Jesus. Your sins were washed away by the blood of Jesus. You were all spiritually blind once as well. That's just, again, the terminologies of Scripture. Even if we had the doors closed, that would have been loud. I just want to close. Not letting that truck drive us off, but I was coming to a conclusion here. I want to close by looking at, in Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3. Now, you remember, in chapters 2 and 3, Jesus is addressing these seven specific churches that are each have very unique characteristics, different positives and negatives. A couple of the churches didn't really have negatives. A couple of them didn't really have any positives. Some had a mixture of both. Each one a fascinating study in its own right. When we taught through the book of Revelation on Sunday mornings, I think we spent a Sunday for each church. So like seven Sundays to cover these seven churches, if my memory serves me on that. But that last church that he addresses, the church of the Laodiceans, in other words, in Laodicea. And he says to them, like he says to all the churches, I know your works. But then to them, he says, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were cold or hot, but because you're lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. You know, hot water does have a purpose. And if you have your hot water and mix it with a little tea or coffee or whatever, it can be very good, right? Cold water certainly has a purpose. That lukewarm stuff can be kind of, ugh. You know, we're not talking about room temperature water. That's one thing. I'm talking that lukewarm, you know, it's just kind of that tepid. It's a little warm, but oh. You spit it out, right? Imagine you think you're getting some cold water or whatever. Oh, man. Okay. Jesus is using that. Why would he use that term? Well, look at what he continues on. And I'm in verse 17, if you took the time to turn there. Verse 17, he says, because you say, I'm rich, I've become wealthy, I have need of nothing. And you do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, because they said they're rich, but then look at this, blind and naked. Now, we haven't talked about this tonight, and I'm not really teaching through Revelation, but naked is another expression that is used in the Bible on multiple occasions in a spiritual way to speak of basically in your sins and therefore in unbelief. Adam and Eve, right? This idea, again, talking of the physical, but then in the spiritual, how they got ashamed. They knew of their sin nature after they disobeyed God and so forth. And you see that over and over again, that you get clothed in the righteousness of Jesus as opposed to your nakedness or maybe your filthy clothing that you were trying to cover your nakedness with. So to be called blind and naked is about as severe as it gets. And he says, I counsel you to buy for me gold refined in the fire that you may be rich, white garments that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and anoint your eyes with eye salve that you may see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten, therefore be zealous and repent. And then most famous verse probably in the whole book of Revelation, verse 20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him and he with me. And that verse is used so often in evangelistic context, of course, right? The idea that Jesus is at the door of your heart knocking, but you have to let him in. There's a very famous picture of illustration of this verse by an artist from many years ago. And you know, you've probably all seen it, or a version of it is very popular. It's out kind of in a garden, and there's this little cottage and the door, and Jesus is knocking, and they've got this verse underneath it. And if you look carefully, you'll notice that there's no doorknob on the outside of the door. Jesus couldn't go in without the door being open to him. The artist was pretty profound in painting it that way. And so I find it fascinating, though, that this tremendous evangelistic message to people who are blind and naked and so forth is to one of these seven churches. And again, without going too far down a Revelation study road, this church really equates with the church at the last days before Jesus returns to this earth, being the seventh church on the timeline that Revelation is unfolding for us. It was a real church in the first century that Jesus is addressing, but in a chronological sequence, and again, we got into all this when we studied Revelation in depth, that idea of people say, oh yeah, we're Christians, we're fine, everything's good. In fact, we're so prosperous because God has so blessed us and all that, and God had a totally different perspective of their real spiritual state. And it's kind of frightening when you put it alongside that last verse in John chapter 9, right? You say you see, and you don't realize you're blind, and your sin remains. Ooh, open the door, you know, I'm knocking. You need to repent and receive me. Heavy stuff. But that blindness comment, again, spiritual blindness, unbelief over and over and over again in the scripture. And here we have Jesus speaking to these Pharisees about this. Again, if there was anyone who thought that they had it all together with God, it was the Pharisees in the first century. And yet, Jesus actually calls them the children of the devil, right? That they don't have God as their father. That they've got a lot of problems. And this really illustrates it. He judges righteously. Earlier in John, Jesus said, don't judge according to just the outward appearance. Judge righteous judgment. This guy got healed. Hey, wait a minute, what day is it? Oh, it's the Sabbath. Oh, you can't do that, right? Just outward appearance. Look at the calendar, it's the Sabbath. Well, then that can't be. It's a sin. Wait a minute, judge righteously, man. Don't just judge on an outward appearance. All right, with that we close. Let's pray. Lord, thank you again for your word and this wonderful man from the past. And again, maybe a boy. We don't know how old he was. But what a wonderful example. And what a powerful lesson and story. Oh, Lord, may we never be like these Pharisees in this story. May we never even be like the parents in the story here. May we recognize that you work in tremendous ways with different people and sometimes beyond what we think is the norm. And there is nothing beyond what you can do in somebody's life. So we praise you and we thank you for this evening. We pray you watch over us as we go back to our homes now and keep us safe, Lord. We pray until we gather together again in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God.